Well, hello everybody, and welcome back to Street Style with me, Prof Halle. And this week we're going to be looking at a very, very strange street style movement and a subculture new to us, although it has evolved from a subculture that we looked at last time, the mods. Today we're going to be looking at Rude Boys and Skinheads, two separate subcultures which, at the onset, converged and were friends and then became, oh, the most ardent of enemies. This is a really fascinating story and I hope you enjoy it. Towards the end of the 60s, many working class British kids, the kids who had affiliated with mod culture, remember the mods, felt that the Peacock Revolution and the hippie movement and all of that was too far removed from their working class beliefs and mores. These kids kept some signifiers of mod culture, the Fred Perry shirt, Ben Sherman, we looked at all of that, didn't we? But they disassociated themselves from the trippy hippie scene by shaving their heads. Remember, we looked at the Peacock Revolution and then a little later how that bled into so-called hippie style and how young men grew their hair very long. Well, these kids rebelled against that by shaving their heads, and they also affiliated themselves with another British working-class subculture. Rude boys, like these two over here. Who were Rude Boys? Well, Rude Boys were the second-generation descendants of Jamaican immigrants. Jamaica gained its independence in 1962 and became an independent nation, and as part of the negotiations for independence, Britain allowed almost unlimited immigration of Jamaicans into the British Isles. So these were the kids of that first generation of Jamaicans who had come over to England and worked terribly hard, particularly in public transport, on the buses, in the underground, places like that. They also worked as doctors and as teachers. So Britain in the early to mid 60s had an influx of Jamaicans who really contributed an awful lot to the culture of Great Britain, especially the working culture. Well, their kids, some of them weren't so keen on either studying to become doctors or working on public transport. They liked to dress up, they liked to listen to reggae, particularly ska music, and old school and dance hall. These are all subgenres of reggae. And they were thought to be quite lippy, a little bit cocky, not very respectful to their elders. So it was in fact their parents who termed this subculture. They called them Rude Boys. Rude Boys, just like the mods did, spent all of their money on clothes. Wonderfully cut tonic suits. Remember, we looked at the tonic suit when we did the mods. And also these hats. See them? They have a name. They are called pork pie hats. Now, if you take a look at that wonderful couple here on the right, you see they are wearing parkas, right? So you see a little bit of mod culture infiltrated into this fabulous Rude Boy style, which was very cool, it was very laid back, it was rather cocky. And as you will see in a second, the Skinheads also took elements of mod culture to create their look. So let's take a look at Skinheads. Skinheads were this group of kids. Now, why am I talking about them in the same lecture as Rude Boys? Because these two cultures were absolutely intertwined at the offset, as I mentioned at the beginning of the lecture. That would not last, sadly. Skinheads were the culture that developed amongst working class kids. It started with the boys, followed by the girls, as always, as we've seen in this course. Skinheads were working class kids who really thought that the whole Peacock Revolution and then later that hippie dippy scene had nothing to do with them. It was getting so completely far away from what they believed in, and they believed in their own working class mores. These were kids who were not economically privileged at all. They were really the lower classes, the working classes, and they were very proud of it. And so we remember what people were wearing in the late 1960s on Carnaby Street. Remember all of those incredible, nostalgic, pseudo-Victorian outfits with paisleys. And then, of course, all of that Indian influence. No, the skinheads hated all of this. They really wanted to get back to a quintessential British feel. And they did so with clothing. Now, of course, they cut their hair incredibly short as a reaction to that long, flowing hippie hair. But their clothing, which was such a uniform, really was the complete opposite to everything else that was going on. Let's break it down. The Ben Sherman or Fred Perry shirt. Now, remember, we saw this with the mods. They were wearing Fred Perry because that was such a posh British establishment thing, and they wanted to make it their own. But Ben Sherman was pure British. It was for them. It was for the young working class. And so the mods, by appropriating Fred Perry, it wasn't because it was upper class or posh. It was because it was English. And Ben Sherman, of course, because that traces back to their mod roots. Braces. Or suspenders, call them what you will. This is the absolute ubiquitous must-have for a skinhead. No belt, you will note, don't need one. Their jeans are held up with braces. Rolled jeans. And then Doc Martin boots. Or, as they are known when a skinhead in England wears them, bother boots. Alright, I have to explain why they're called bother boots. Working class Cockneys pronounce TH as a V. So bother sounds like bother. It's a lot of bother in it. Do you want some bother? Do you want a bit of bother? Bother, of course, is a British slang euphemism for violence, for trouble. Do you want a bit of bother? Right? So these are actually known as bother boots. And skinheads were sometimes known as boot boys. So this really is the look, but then you add, weirdly, a cardigan, often a shawl-collared cardigan, and then at the beginning of the skinhead movement, a pork pie hat. You see, there was this dialogue between skinheads and rude boys at the beginning. Skinheads would last a very long time. Eventually, later, combat pants would become part of the uniform, as would a bomber jacket, as would later on in the 70s when skinheads would affiliate themselves with the awful racist National Front movement, Union Jack things, Union Jack scarves, Union Jack t-shirts. Why? Oi, we're British. Oi is the word that skinheads use. Oi, it's like hey, but more aggressively, oi. So a Union Jack scarf, what's that saying? Well, it's saying, oi, get out of my country. This is England. You don't belong here. So ironic, because skinheads actually began as such ardent supporters of Jamaican culture, but we'll see how it all went wrong. And here we have the look together. Take a look at this couple here. She has very, very short hair too. We'll look at some of the weird things that skin girls did with their hair. Skinheads, you can just call them skins. They have their braces on, but look how high up their trousers are. Here are two skin girls. You can see she has the Fred Perry shirt on. They both have Fred Perry shirts on, actually. They've got their bother boots, and they both have cardigans on. One tied around the waist, one just worn. But cardigans are very kind of British as well, aren't they? Like this, a great colour image of two skins in the late 60s, early 70s. So let's look at hair as a subculture signifier again. How many times have we looked at hair? Remember, we saw it with the greasers, with those incredible pompadours, and the Teds as well, and they took the pompadour to great new heights. We saw it with the mods, and those fabulous affected mod haircuts. Then of course we saw it with the Peacock Revolution, we saw it with the hippies with hair getting long as a political statement. Skinheads used hair for the very same reasons. They wanted to set themselves apart from everything else that was going on. They wanted to show no affiliation to America. They had no interest in protesting against the war in Vietnam, for example. No! That was a war America was involved in, and they were British and proud of it. And they also wanted to get back to these very working class roots. We don't have the money or the time or the inclination to grow our hair out and fart around with our hair all day. It was an incredibly macho subculture, and this shaved hair was a signifier of all of that. Mod girls did very strange things with their hair. Some shaved it all off like the boys, but others tried to feminize it like this, with bangs and long tendrils at the side or down the back, and bangs, a very odd look, like this. Not the most attractive look, I don't think. And you can see she has written the name of her boyfriend, Kevo, on her face. However, although she has written on her face, Skins would go on to tattoo their faces a little bit later. I love this. Head teacher bans 6 girls over skinhead haircuts. 6 girls claimed yesterday that they have been banned from school outings because their headmistress does not like their skinhead hairdos. See, already, this hairdo was a signifier of trouble, wasn't it? And here's another example of two girls with these incredibly attractive hairdos, and they are pulling their lips down to show that they have had their inner lip tattooed. So it's on the inner lip, so their mums won't see. Most probably this picture is from the early 1980s, actually. Just to show you that skinhead culture really lasted a very, very long time. Stronger or less strong, but it was always prevalent. As we have seen already, and will continue to see as we know, many street-style subcultures have labels of choice. For the skinheads, it was, as I just mentioned, Ben Sherman, Fred Perry, and then Lonsdale. You all know Lonsdale, don't you? It's a sportswear that's affiliated with boxing and martial arts. Lonsdale. So already we're seeing a tiny bit of interest in violence coming in to skinhead culture with their choice of Lonsdale as a label. And here are some original skinheads wearing Ben Sherman shirts. Here is an original skin wearing Fred Perry. And here is an original skin in his Lonsdale. Rude boys and skinheads, incredible though it is to imagine, especially now when skinheads are so associated with racism, they were once the best of friends, and they were brought together not only by feeling like working class outcasts who didn't relate at all to what was happening in the rest of youth culture. They could not relate to hippie style, and then in the early 70s they certainly couldn't relate to glam rock. They were brought together primarily with music. Look at these lads here. You can see these are skinheads, and there is a rude boy with his pork pie hat. The music of choice that both skinheads and rude boys loved was ska. Ska is the music that you're listening to now, obviously. And ska music, which is a subgenre of reggae, was the music of choice, particularly from the Trojan label. Trojan Records, established in 1968, was a reggae record label. And now, to show this wonderful moment when skinheads and rude boys actually got along, I'm going to show you a wonderful clip from a British documentary. Enjoy.
The skinheads were the latest tribe to emerge from the fertile sartorial breeding ground of working-class British youth. And this latest group fascinated the chattering classes.
In accepting reggae, the skinheads had rejected the middle class with its existential, mystical, hippie-style music, which is unable to cater to the social needs of the skinheads. Through the medium of the reggae, the black youth does this extremely well.
Tony Haddo was one of the first skinheads to walk the streets of London.
We thought Jamaicans were naturally cool. The way they walked, the way they moved, the way they danced, and relaxed, the way they talked. You know, we wanted a little bit of it.
And the way they got it was through clothes. Tony and his mates were meticulous in their attempts to adapt the rude boy look.
Not the blue. Got a nice lining on that one.
And once they found it, they were willing to pay.
All the money we had actually went on to the fashion and the music. The shoes were like £8 a pair, which was more than a week's wages as an apprentice plumber in the 60s. So, yeah, it did cost a lot of money. There's one of me in black and white with my early girlfriend. And there's me with a pair of Tonic Mohair trousers on. There you go, 2-3 inches off the shoe. I've got a check shirt on, a tailored jacket, hanky in the pocket, and again, you can see the parting in the hair.
The essentials of skinhead style are enduring. Mohair tonic suits. Check button-down shirt. Rolled-up slim-cut jeans. Loafers, brogues, and Doc Martin boots. Through their love of a sharp style, white skins and black rude boys had found common ground. And it wasn't long before this moment of cultural harmony was given a soundtrack all of its own.
We got 3 million miles to reach on the moon. Yeah, 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 yeah!
Skinhead Moonstop was a defining track of the era.
You know, it was massive in the clubs. It had such a good sound to it, and it was sort of an anthem in a way. You know, it's something people could actually dance together to, get involved in. And to see, like, 300-plus skinheads all doing this stamping dance, it was very exciting for us.
That's what I say, boy. Remember, I'm your boss, Skinhead speaking. My name is Caleb. Right.
Moonstomp was a homegrown reggae hit, written and produced exclusively for skinheads.
Or my feet, whatever you want to call it.
It was a special skinhead dance. One drum, and one little nudge. One little nudge, yeah. This was a nice dance.
From the headquarters of his international business empire, Frank Pitter still remembers the glory days. As the drummer in the band Simmerip, he helped put the stomp in Moonstomping.
This skinhead Moonstomp. We're the skinhead boys. I'm in the front, and just on the back. Yeah. If you can look at the top here, that's me. I think we were the first band to record in something targeting skinheads, something for them, you know. And we did a skinhead Moonstomp, you know, and we put our thing into the national charts. This sold over 4 million copies. Yeah. The music, fashion, they go together. You're doing the music, you haven't got the clothes to go with it, the fashion, the style. You know, it's half job done. It's not the full job. So you got to have the clothes with the music. And then you're fully there. Yeah.
This was a glorious moment in post-war Britain. Two cultures brought together through music and fashion. but it wasn't to last.
Get it, stick together!
Listen, everyone, we're all white, together. Okay? So stop fighting and stick together. Don't matter.
Across the 70s, many skinheads would be corrupted by far-right politics. Out went the moon stump, and in came the bother boot. And these skinheads became like an army, marching on bigotry and violence.
Well, as you probably got from the clip, by the 70s, the mid-70s, disillusioned with the lack of money and opportunity available to them, many skinheads took a scary, dark turn, blaming Britain's relatively open immigration policy on their own lack of prospects, and joined the National Front. Just to reiterate, the National Front is a very right-wing fringe political party in the United Kingdom, although nearly every country has its own National Front. And it is extremely racist, as this poster here lets you know. How racist is that? Your last chance, the National Front. They are evil, they are vile, their slogan, their catchphrase, it embarrasses me to tell you. And I am only saying these words in terms of a lecture to try to get across just how vile these people are. Their catchphrase is, if they're black, send them back. How disgusting is that? And also, send them back where? At this point, we're talking third, even fourth generation Jamaicans or Indians or Pakistanis. You know, these are the immigrant population of Great Britain. So the National Front are vile, yet so many skinheads joined them. Like these ones here, look, the British movement. Isn't that disgusting? Look at these two skinheads. You'll note the one on the right is wearing his Ben Sherman shirt. The one on the left has the bomber jacket, and look, that sort of Nazi SS insignia hanging from his zip. And look how charming he is giving the Nazi party salute. And they were violent. They were violent. Look at this newspaper headline, Beasts, Boot Gang, Savages, a Victim. They were scary, these people. I remember in England, being a child in the 70s, go out into town to go shopping. Sometimes you would see these characters, these bother boys as they were known, these skinheads walking about. Just a fashion note, I forgot to mention, often they had sideburns as well. You'll notice that all of these boys have sideburns. And they were really aggressive. They were violent. Even if you were white, they would shout obscene things at you. Oi, what are you looking at? You effing this, you effing that. Really, really nasty, nasty piece of work these characters were. And it was at this point that skinheads started getting tattoos. Often a Christian type of cross, although they certainly weren't Christians. And look, made in London. Now listen, not every skinhead is a racist, and not every skinhead's tattoos are racist. But many are. And it was skinheads before anyone who started tattooing their faces. So, you know, we looked at gangs, American street gangs, at the beginning of this semester. And we saw some of them, some of you in the discussion board, highlighted certain gangs who tattooed their whole faces. Well, you know what? It started in England, and it started with the skinheads. Why does everything bad seem to start in England? And everything good, too. Skinheads had their own type of music. Now, like I said, not every skinhead was a racist, but every skinhead liked a genre of music that developed in the 70s, completely different to ska or reggae, called oi. Oi was the type of music. It was sort of an offshoot of punk. Very aggressive music. Bands like the Cockney Rejects and Sham 69. Now, neither of these bands are remotely racist, to my knowledge. However, they affiliated very much with skinhead style, and Oi music. It's very punky, very aggressive, very, very British. I want to take a moment to tell you about Suede Heads. And here are some Suede Heads. Suede Heads were an early 70s offshoot of skinheads. They dressed more formally, with longer hair, they wore brogues instead of bobber boots, and often had very white-collared jobs. They tended not to be racist, suede heads. They were a slightly posher offshoot of skinheads, and I just wanted you to be aware of them, with their lovely tailored long coats, and their brogues, and their Ben Sherman shirts. Still, you're still getting all of these labels. But just in case you ever hear the phrase suede head, you'll know what it means and what it looks like, right? So let's look at skinhead subcultures and street style today. Well, unfortunately, skinhead style and all of these sartorial signifiers, the bother boots, the combat pants, etc., are very much affiliated with neo-Nazi groups around the world. This neo-Nazi skinhead here is actually from Brooklyn. But take a look at this. You're not looking at a racist, you're looking at a skinhead. 100% skinhead, 100% anti-racist. So you see, you can be a skinhead and you can be absolutely the biggest asshole racist in town, or look 100% anti-racist. But here's the problem I have with all of this. If you are 100% anti-racist, why do you want to dress and cut your hair like a group that is so synonymous with racism? So look at this couple here. Are they 100% anti-racist or 100% racist? I don't know. But I tell you what, I wouldn't risk it no matter how much I like skinhead style. I wouldn't want anyone to even assume I might be slightly racist or even have that question in their minds. So it's very interesting to me, and it's going to be something we look at in the discussion board. Why people who are not racist want to identify with the sartorial signifiers of racist skinhead culture. It's interesting, isn't it? But a group that are certainly not racist are those who subscribe to something called Trojan style. Trojan, does that sound familiar? Of course, it's the reggae record label, right? That the original skinheads and the original Rude Boys so loved, Trojan style. And this is a street style look that is marked by some of these signifiers of a skinhead culture. But the kids who dress this way, like this boy here, remember the spirit of 69. 69 is the year that was sort of the golden year, if you will, of skinheads not being racist and hanging out with rude boys and clubbing together and listening to wonderful Jamaican reggae. And here are some images that exemplify Trojan street style. Now take a look at her. She's got her Lonsdale t-shirt on, she's got her Doc Martens, and she has sort of an adapted version of the skin girl haircut. As does she. She has her bomber jacket on with lots of badges and buttons, and again, a modified version of that haircut. As does she. She has got her Fred Perry shirt on. This is all Trojan style, which is, I think, a lot less provocative, isn't it, than saying skinhead style. And take a look at her. She's something of a street style icon, actually, for her Trojan style, and she's got a Trojan Records t-shirt on. So let's look at skinhead, Trojan, rude boy street style today. Recent street images for you. Like this pair here. They look like mum and daughter, actually, don't they? You can see they have their Ben Sherman on, they have their Doc Martens, and she's carrying a Lonsdale bag, and they both have more contemporary versions of that weird skinhead haircut. He's really going rude boy, isn't he? Remember there was that dialogue at the beginning between mod/skin signifiers like Ben Sherman shirts? He's got the braces, but he's also got that pork pie hat. He's gone full on skinhead. And he's gone full on rude boy. You see, this is why you need to know about all of these subcultures when examining street style today. And let's take a look at high fashion's take on retro low culture. Here are some runway images obviously inspired by skinheads. And look at that editorial. Scarface, go one step beyond bobber boots with these threads for latter-day rude boys. And look at that editorial. Oi! Fall fashion takes its cues from the street by emulating the gritty punk aesthetic of British youth culture. Again, a little bit of confusion there that fashion writers often have because skinheads had nothing to do with punk rock. Two completely different subcultures. That's the kind of thing that annoys me. But here's the question that we're going to be discussing in this week's discussion board. Sure, there are a whole bunch of skinheads who are absolutely against racism. Look at this, skinheads against racial prejudice. But there's an awful lot who are racist, and proudly so. So, do most people associate skinhead style with racism and hate crimes? And even if they don't, should high fashion and street style be channeling the signature look of neo-Nazis? Because if it does, and if they do, really, it's only a step away from this, isn't it? These are some hot and heavy topics we're going to be discussing in this week's discussion board. I hope you've enjoyed, or at least found interesting, this week's lecture, and I hope you've enjoyed listening to some ska. It's one of my favourite genres of music. I'll see you over on the discussion board. All right, bye for now.